The Athletic had an expose on the New York football Jets. It was earth-shattering in some ways, but I'm a little bit skeptical about some other things in there. I want to defend the New York Jets, and that's a dicey proposition. So I brought in a New York Jets expert, Mike Meltser, my former co-host at Sports Radio 610. You can listen to him on Sirius next weekend, Super Bowl weekend, from 3 to 7 p.m. on Saturday. And then starting at midnight, you've got like the post-post game show after
post-post.
The Super Bowl, right? Okay.
Yeah. So a lot of West Coast people, I think. Yeah, basically, yes. I don't have to do that weird thing. It's like, good morning, even though it feels like the night, like that weird radio thing.
You're going to get, yes. Well, you're a night owl. You're not going to get sleepy.
That is true. I'm a night owl.
So I wanted to talk to you about this because you are, I would say, a long-suffering Jets fan, except you're also a Michigan fan, so it's not like it's been an awful year for you. So congratulations on the University of Michigan winning their title.
Thank you.
And this Jets article, I was kind of surprised when I read it in The Athletic, and I'll just read the first paragraph for anybody that hasn't seen it or doesn't know what I'm talking about. It was by Zach Rosenblatt and Diana Russini. This is one of the opening paragraphs. Offensive players felt like Rodgers' handpicked offensive coordinator Nathaniel Hackett failed to adjust after losing his quarterback and didn't put them in positions to succeed. The Jets lost 5 games by 20 or more points and extended the longest playoff drought in the 4 major North American professional sports to 13 years. It's just such an effing mess, one Jets coach said. Something has to change. And we'll go on to discuss Nathaniel Hackett, Robert Saleh, and Aaron Rodgers, of course. But I was kind of surprised in the comments that there was a lot of support for Zach Rosenblatt and Diana Russini. I expected more defensiveness from Jets fans. Am I off the mark there, or is that just like the civilized commenters in The Athletic?
No, I do think they have a better comments section because of the subscription than other places have.
Yeah.
So here's my thought. Let me pull back like the curtain here. So I actually, prior to last night and this morning, I actually had not read the full story. I was aware of the story immediately when it came out. And so I think you'd appreciate this, Seth. The way I consumed the story was I heard everybody talk about the story. I heard this one guy, a really good call to Adam Schein's show on Sirius XM, I think Thursday, like have a heated discussion with Adam about the article. And then I actually read the article. So I had that whole thing where it's like you hear about a movie and you hear all these thoughts and you actually see it.
Yeah.
It's kind of a different perspective.
You watch and it. And you're like, oh, half these people are idiots that were talking about this. They don't know.
Yes. So I didn't think it was like taking a blowtorch to the organization. That wasn't my sense. I think the perspective of the Jets fan, especially the diehards, is, yes, we know the organization is kind of a mess. It's kind of not really structured properly, or there are issues internally. And just look at the results the last 13 years.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of the things that are in the article are things that people discussed or theorized on social media. And so I think the thought was like, okay, some Jets fans, including this guy who called Adam Schein, was like, hey, we've known this organization is dysfunctional.
Yeah.
We know they should have arguably fired the coach a month ago, 2 months ago, a year ago. Like, what did we learn from this article? Now, here's my take. I'm very curious what you think.
Yeah.
To me, the guy who came across looking the worst in this article was Robert Saleh.
Yeah.
Would you agree with that or disagree?
What do you think? Disagree with it. And that's where, as I was reading the evidence that they had, and I don't know if I should call it evidence or not, but you know, the word paranoid was used in this article. And the evidence that they would have used to suggest that, the one that I found curious was after there was that report about Zach Wilson not wanting to play and then had to be convinced to play, or he came in and told Robert Saleh that, you know, he wanted to play, all of that, they said things went sideways for Saleh after the report and after Aaron Rodgers had gone on McAfee to talk about the leaks in the organization. So, quote, that sent Saleh into a tailspin. The coach held a meeting with his staff 2 days later where he asked the leaker to reveal himself, according to multiple people in attendance. If you come forward now, you won't get in trouble, he told them, while threatening to take their cell phones. Staffers were bemused by Saleh's obsession with the Wilson story and his reaction to it. So I'm torn on this because, okay, asking to take the cell phones, I don't know, that might be a little bit over the top. But there's a certain irony in this where the evidence for Robert Saleh being paranoid is a meeting that he called in which he was concerned about leaks. And the reason The Athletic knows about it is because multiple people in attendance leaked the story about about Salah addressing the leak. So like, is it really paranoia if people are out to get you? I don't know. The part where I think I would agree with you with Salah is it seems like for being in that New York market, he maybe has rabbit ears too much. And like, I don't know if you even call them rabbit ears. It's like listening at all when you're coaching for the Jets. There's a certain amount of scrutiny that you're going to get, whether it's fair or not, that your quarterback got injured and you're not going to do well without it. You can't just harp on that. Cause there's stories in here about him apparently saying pretty frequently, like, hey, what do you expect? We lost our quarterback.
Well, and that's what fascinates me. That's why you and I might see this slightly differently. I was thinking of you, Seth, when I read this particular part. So the Jets, remember they lost to the Dolphins in week 12. This is the Javon Holland 99-yard Black Friday game, right?
It's the Boyle start, right?
Yes, the Tim Boyle start. God, that guy might be the worst quarterback I've seen play in an NFL game.
But he's buddies with Aaron.
Oh, God.
I'm going to flop already. All right, now you know what? The Jets are screwed. Okay.
But Seth, this part of the story, in the days after an embittered Salah conducted research, he wanted to see how teams led by the NFL's best coaches perform when playing without their star quarterback. And he found that Belichick, McCarthy, John Harbaugh, Zach Taylor, Mike McDaniel, Kyle Shanahan, and Sean McVay all had losing records in those situations, and that Mike Tomlin was the lone exception. I realize that, like, okay, I guess because of the Black Friday, they had an extra few days. But I'm sitting here, I'm like, wait a second. This is an NFL head coach, right? They work all the time. Robert Saleh is taking time out of his day to conduct research into how elite NFL coaches perform without their star quarterbacks. Like, why is he doing research on that?
I know. That's where I'm curious. Okay, was it research, or was it like how all of us did our own COVID research? Is it like, yeah. I mean, did he take an intern and say, hey, like, find this for me and figure this out? I just Googled, what is the record of good head coaches when their quarterbacks are injured? And all right, I would have to do a little bit more research. Because I forgot to write NFL in there.
yes.
Well, isn't this what he had also texted to one of the radio hosts up there? And the radio host ended up putting it on blast. Oh, yes. Yeah. He put it out to everybody, right?
So here's where I'm kind of split. So on the one hand, I think to myself that, Seth, that when I look at the Jets season overall, the season was over the moment that Rodgers got hurt, right? Like, just realistically, in the sense of the hopes and the potential expectations, like, you're not going to advance deep in the playoffs or win a Super Bowl with your backup quarterback, unless we're talking about like 2 to 3 situations in the last 50 years of NFL football. So that's one part of my thought. But the other part is, and this was a consistent tone throughout the article, Rodgers goes down and Salah sets some sort of internal expectation of like 7 wins. And throughout the whole story, you know, whether we agree or disagree on certain like anecdotes and how they're presented, it's like, it just seems like he's a guy who almost feels bad for himself, right? Mm-hmm. That he's in this situation. And I think it's very difficult from a Jets perspective to look at this. And then the counter of this is what Kevin Stefanski did in Cleveland when they lost to Deshaun Watson. Granted, he played a couple more games, but they cycled through a bunch of quarterbacks. They got to Flacco. And what, Cleveland won, I think, 12 games this season.
Yeah.
And they were, you know, they were a team that was competing, at least for a while, at the top of the AFC. Like the Cleveland Browns, and that wasn't the only injury that they had.
And they're doing it with a quarterback that was totally available to the Jets. Yeah.
Exactly. Now, it was technically 11-6, but Cleveland also had the offensive tackle issues. They had a bunch of guys on IR, and it feels to me like Cleveland was able to, you know, go into their garage with like duct tape and a bunch of random things and put together a workable product.
Yeah.
Whereas the Jets sort of felt like they felt bad for themselves and they weren't able to fight out of it after the midpoint of the season.
Yeah.
That's what bothers me. And I'll tell you this also. So I was on Mad Dog Radio after the Black Friday game, like right after that game. And you know me very well. I pride myself on like taking an approach that's kind of like rational, logical, or at least what I think it is. And I went on the air that night and I was like, I think the Jets need to fire their coach. Mm-hmm. And because they need to fire their coach, I think they need to fire their GM to have a clean slate. And I thought about the next couple of days. I'm like, ah, did I overreact? And the more I think about it, like, I don't think I did, in the sense that I like Robert Saleh as a guy. I thought the hire made a lot of sense. But Seth, when you look at the amount of times the Jets have been blown out by like 20 or more points in the last 3 years, I think it's actually more than the amount of wins that they've had. It's something along those lines. Like, how do you, with a defense like they have, which is good to very good, in this NFL with as much mediocrity, I know they had kind of a tough schedule, but like, how are you constantly so non-competitive in this league?
Well, and this is where I think where the parts where I would agree with scrutiny of Saleh, and where I think sometimes maybe it's just that he's a first-time head coach, and whatever his chronological age is, maybe his age in coaching years isn't quite there yet. But I felt like during Hard Knocks, one of those little moments that Jets fans were happy about, but I didn't quite get, was when he was lambasting the Jets offensive line, because he was doing it in such a way that he was talking, he made repeated references to how good the defense was. And I'm thinking, man, you're a defensive coach. Like, you run the defense. You got to be careful here, because you're setting the stage for finger pointing when you do that. Now, I know that publicly the Jets defense didn't do that at all this year, but it did feel like what a defensive coach would say to the offense when things are going all right for him and not for the offense. Like, and that's one little sliver. But I think I guess paranoia is too strong a word for me. But I think maybe not being able to keep somewhat of an even keel and understand that, look, your quarterback's gone, it's going to suck. And there's going to be a lot of slings and arrows put at you. But they also won 6 games. And they also, and I know it didn't feel like those 6
7
games.
Yes.
7 games. That's right. Yeah. 7 games. They won 7 games.
Give them the full credit.
right. Which honestly, where, you know how I feel about this. Like, for the most part, in an NFL, on an NFL team, your GM, your head coach, and your quarterback can pretty much overcome any amount of dysfunction. And yes. I don't know if Aaron Rodgers is going to be still good enough to overcome that dysfunction, but I guess it's easy for me to visualize a team that won 7 games getting, let's say it's a fully functional Aaron Rodgers back.
Sure.
And like, that's 11, 12, 13 wins, possibly, just with that quarterback, even with Nathaniel Hackett as your offensive coordinator. And I guess I have a hard time figuring out, is this kind of like when Texans fans could say, look, we know Lovie Smith isn't to blame for the Texans being bad right now, but we also know Lovie Smith isn't the solution. Is that how it feels for Jets fans?
I think to an extent, yes. Like, you can, going back to my point about like the season realistically ending the moment that Rodgers got hurt, that these things that people were talking about this week, like dysfunctional organization, too many leaks, all these things, that it could still be the case. But if Rodgers was playing even at an above average level, they possibly could have made the playoffs, maybe probably would have made the playoffs. And then all these things with the organization kind of go away, even though they kind of they realistically seem true anyway, I think, to your point. So I think the other Jets frustration is, if you kind of look and zoom out the last year and a half, so Joe Douglas drafts Zach Wilson at number 2 overall in 2021, almost 3 years ago at this time. I supported the pick. I liked the pick. I was totally wrong about the pick. So were they. So then you go to 2022, and they had a very good defense, and they just had this hole at quarterback. But the thought was, you got Breece Hall coming back. You have Garrett Wilson. Like, you have some pieces on offense, but you need a quarterback. And what the Jets did in trading for Aaron Rodgers is, to me, very similar to the Bucs picking up Tom Brady or the Rams trading for Matt Stafford. There might be one or two other examples, but basically, like, bringing in sort of a hired gun at quarterback where there was an obvious hole. Mm-hmm. So sometimes when I look at what's happened since the Rodgers trade, my pushback is like, okay, they get blame for drafting Zach Wilson. And I think ultimately that pick will probably cost the GM and the head coach their jobs, ultimately. But at the end of 2022, if we were having this conversation exactly a year ago, like, what should they have done? Mm-hmm. At that point, they could have signed Derek Carr. They could have signed Jimmy Garoppolo. You know, they weren't going to trade into the top 2 or 3 and pick any of these quarterbacks. So I think, and I still believe, their best solution at that time was trading for Aaron Rodgers, mm-hmm. right? Like, would you agree or disagree on that?
I agree with it, except to the extent that, you know, ultimately all these conversations pro sports, you work your way up to the owner level with Woody Johnson. I don't know what, can you sign Aaron Rodgers? Could they have signed Aaron Rodgers without also evidently giving away a big chunk of their self-esteem and autonomy at the same time. Like,
fair.
I know the one quote in here, which again, it's somebody else's opinion. This is one of those things that it's turned into like somehow it's actual news. Like it's cloaked as a nugget somehow when it's just an anonymous opinion from somebody else. But one of the executives from another team said that, I must have deleted it, said that Joe Douglas was the assistant GM and that yes. Aaron Rodgers is the actual GM. That's not like a report from somebody within the organization. That's an anonymous executive from outside the organization. But when you start looking at the Randall Cobb pickup or the Tim Boyle existence, or, you know, Alan Lazard at least made sense, I guess. Was it worth all that? And is Aaron Rodgers actually any different than he was in Green Bay because they've accommodated him? Like, was that really necessary to lure Aaron Rodgers there, or could they have done it without all of that?
That to me is a fantastic question, because it reminds me a lot of James Harden and the Rockets, especially towards the end. Like, you want to have this balance, Seth, where you want to involve your superstar player because he's sort of the sun and everything revolves around him realistically. And at the same time, the star player or the superstar is not a talent evaluator.
Yeah.
That's not what they do. The organization, like Joe Douglas and the people in the front office, that's what they do. And this is the part I struggle with, because there's a part of me that feels like Aaron's now 40 and he was 39 last season. So there's a part of me that's like, okay, you hear all these practice reports. He looked good in the one drive in the preseason. Like, my brain tells me if he had played all 17 games, like, I think he would have been at minimum, like, slightly above average to me. Uh-huh. And you combine it with the defense, and to your earlier point, like, I think it would have been a pretty good team. But I really struggle with, like, I have to admit, and this probably isn't just for football reasons, but Rodgers was once one of my favorite players, and I'll obviously root for him when he's on the field this year. Like, he is tough to take.
Yeah,
I mean, he is one of these guys, like, where you sort of feel like, okay, you had this separation from your family, and not that I'm one to talk, but he's like single at his age with his money. You can kind of like see, like, it almost feels like with the McAfee stuff that he feels that like the world kind of revolves around him and he's like the smartest guy in the room, which is like the opposite of how I approach my life, essentially. <Yeah. laughs> And so it's like Randall Cobb, we know about him in Houston, like he's done. That didn't really make a lot of sense. Like, Billy Turner, like the Tim Boyle thing is almost indefensible. Lazard. And remember, Seth, remember Rodgers had that one news conference in Green Bay like a year and a half ago when he talked very openly about the Gutekunst stuff, the GM there?
Yeah.
Where and one of the Q&As I love was, there was a guy in the Milwaukee Green Bay media. He was like, Aaron, like, if you look at some of these decisions that like they made or what you would want them to do, like, these would have been mistakes had they brought these guys back.
Yeah.
And I think Aaron even kind of acknowledged that in his answer, but he still wanted a role. And I'm just looking at this and I think it's a great point. If the Jets didn't exist, where would Rodgers have gone last season? Because I think Green Bay clearly wanted to move on.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the right decision.
Yeah. And that's where I wonder, like, it's one of those things where, okay, it's like getting married. If you have to make a bunch of concessions to get married, then this might not be the best sign for the marriage. You know, if you're like, if you really don't want to convert to Catholicism, but I guess I will, but I really don't want to do it. I don't think it's okay. That's, you got issues there. Like, you shouldn't get married until you figure that out. I feel like the Jets had to make a bunch of concessions. And with Rodgers, like, he's like the old GM of the Packers that drafted Aaron Rodgers. I'm blanking on his name.
It was Ted Thompson.
Yeah, Ted Thompson. What he'd always said, he was an interesting guy. You know, he spoke.
That's right. I remember that. Yes. Him.
Yeah.
Yes.
He's an interesting dude. But I'm like, he's trying to go through this journey with the ayahuasca and everything else, which is very much, you know, in that world, it's about, you know, destroying your own ego.
And it was all about a major ego death. It was going to the depths of my soul and hearing and feeling all that self-criticism, all that doubt, all that judgment that I placed on myself, and sitting with it for hours.
You know, and he actually put money back on the table to help improve the team.
He did.
I feel like he genuinely wants to do those things, but this past year, or so, it's been a little bit like a lot of people are kind of like new converts in religion. Like they're pretty unbearable at first. Like the newly saved, like the just recently yes. born again, like they can be a lot to the point where they get so spiritual that they're the worst Christians ever. Like yes. likewise, sometimes you can kill your ego so thoroughly that you end up having the biggest ego in the world because you're like, oh, I wish everybody else could just see how incredible it is to be egoless like this.
People are out there with like all this ego, but once you've been to enough transformational festivals, and we've been to probably more than anybody else,
we've been to every festival,
you just don't have an ego anymore. Like we have no ego.
No ego.
We've been to so many festivals,
all of them,
that we've just been able to delete our ego.
What even is ego?
Rogers has been there for a while. I think maybe he started in on the transition to like being a genuine hippie sometime during this season. I don't know. I know yeah. he's still going to say things on McAfee that are going to piss a lot of people off. I'm trying to talk you into being excited about Aaron Rodgers.
I mean, I will say this. When Rodgers went down, my disappointment the next 3 days, this is how I felt. Yeah. It wasn't so much like, oh, this team missed a chance on going to the Super Bowl or whatever. My thought was basically, I've gone through, you know, Josh McCown, Sam Darnold, Bryce Petty, you know, Mark Sanchez ultimately being a disappointment, Geno Smith, like all these different guys. My thought was, I just want to watch good, competent quarterback play
yeah.
every Sunday. I think Texans fans can relate to that pretty well on that front. Like
except when they're playing the Jets or the Panthers somehow, but yeah.
Yeah, somehow, yes. Like the best game that Wilson's probably played was against Houston.
Yeah.
Like that was my big disappointment. And I think the hard thing about next season is I don't think they have a whole lot of options. Like, I think they have to be all in with Rodgers. I would not do anything crazy like trade for Davante Adams. I would not sacrifice the future. But you just look at, you know, the AFC and Seth, just how many teams in the AFC next season. Nick Wright talked about this on one of his shows, I think, on FS1. How many teams in the AFC are going into 2024 like definitively expecting to make the playoffs?
Mm-hmm.
Think like if we pull up the standings right now, to me, those teams would like definitively of the seven spots, Buffalo would be one.
Yeah.
Let's leave off the other AFC East teams. Buffalo would be one. Baltimore would definitely be one. I think Cincinnati with Burrow would be another. That's mm-hmm. three. I would say the Texans might be in that category with year two of D'Amico and Stroud with four.
The other, I'll put him there. I think that a lot of people are really evaluating and looking at the schedule and seeing like, oh, there's a lot more. Yeah. But yeah. They should reasonably expect it. Yeah.
Yeah. Like if the Texans miss the playoffs, that would be a disappointment. Yeah. Obviously, Kansas City would be another. And then you kind of think about like, you know, and then you get to the sort of the other teams. But that's arguably five teams.
Yeah.
That it's like if we don't make the playoffs, it's like a significant disappointment for different reasons. And then we start mixing in the Miami Dolphins, the New York Jets, the Browns, the Steelers, the Jaguars, yeah. the Colts,
the Chargers. I mean,
the Chargers yeah. definitely yeah. with Harbaugh. yeah. Like you think about that from a math standpoint, and yeah. I go back to the coach, and I want to like Robert Saleh. I like him as a guy, but I think, and this is the exact stat I had yeah. a little bit earlier, Seth, the Jets have more losses by 14 plus points than they have total wins under Saleh. 17 blowouts against 16 total wins. To get that in perspective.
I think the biggest thing, if I were going to step back and say, all right, if you could go back in time and do it all over again, but you could only do one thing, at the very least, I think that whatever you had to do to attract Aaron Rodgers, and let's say that like Robert Saleh is off the board, that you're not going to fire Robert Saleh and bring somebody in new. If you could go back in time and do one thing that would make me feel better about the future of the Jets right now, it would have been if they had hired some offensive coordinator other than Nathaniel Hackett, which they
great
did.
Point.
They did that as a beacon to welcome Aaron Rodgers before. It's not like Aaron Rodgers had insisted upon that, right? The Jets just knew that Aaron had an affinity for this guy who's like the most
yes.
disorganized. I say this, I don't need any of the quotes from the article to tell me a thing about how disorganized this dude is. I watched yes. him with the Broncos last year. Most pre-snap penalties in the league this year. It's a mess. That's yes. where I don't. And I know in the story, they talk about how they're going to maybe try to give Nathaniel Hackett more support or what have you.
Which already tells you they don't really believe in this guy, if that's right out there.
So I don't know. That's where Aaron Rodgers, I think, whatever he feels about doing it his way, where he seemingly just wants to surround himself with a bunch of his buddies, like that, like making hard decisions when you're the wannabe GM includes firing your friends. And there's got to be some part of Rodgers that understands that Nathaniel Hackett's not the guy.
Well, that's what I wonder about, because you look at Hackett's recent history as an offensive coordinator, and it's like, how would you present this in a favorable light?
Yeah.
Like, the only thing I can think of is, okay, maybe the combination of him and Rodgers is just, there's some kind of magical sauce that Rodgers won the MVP in 2020 and 2021. And this is the one way that you can win with Hackett as your OC, because otherwise
without LaFleur as your head coach and actual OC, right?
Yes. And I wasn't even a huge fan of them firing Mike LaFleur a year ago, because my thought was like, if you watch the Jets in 2021 and 2022, when they looked their best offensively, it was when Zach Wilson was hurt or benched. When Josh Johnson came in, when Mike White came in, not that it was great, but like the offense looked like it was a normal NFL offense.
Yeah.
And yeah, the Hackett thing, I wonder the same thing as you do, that you do, that I don't, the article talks about, and again, it's an anonymous source, whatever. The criticism is he lacks attention to detail.
Yeah.
How can an NFL offensive coordinator lack attention to detail? That is what they do, right?
I know.
Isn't that what they do?
It's one of the things that drives me most insane when I see teams that obviously don't pay attention to detail. Like that's the number one requirement, is to be obsessive about detail as an offensive coordinator, because it's not like, if you're not, you got to take your ass back to college where you can recruit a bunch of studs and just outrun people. Because other than that, like that's the thing, especially in the offense that they want to run. It's got to be about precision and making everything look exactly the same. The run's got to look like the pass and vice versa. So, all right, you've succeeded in, I feel like a Jets fan, I think. I think I came into this trying to talk myself into being optimistic about the Jets, and you've thoroughly beat me down into submission.
I'm kind of neutral. Like I'm basically in a situation where I don't fully believe in the coach. I think it's very hard to have this much pressure going into 2024 in such a competitive division and conference. But there's the other part of me that's like, you know what? They're all in with Rodgers. Hopefully he stays healthy. Let's roll the dice and see what happens.
Yeah.
That's where I have to be, because I think that's the only option.
I do think, honestly, despite all the dysfunction, it's the quarterback matters that much. And I think that Robert Saleh does, however paranoid people might feel like he was or anything, a lot of the greatest leaders in history and the most effective dictators for sure have been paranoid as hell. So the right amount of paranoia with the right quarterback, and you're off to the races, and a hell of a defense. So
it's a good defense. Yeah. So we shall see. We shall see. All right.
Mike Meltser, listen to him on Sirius XM this weekend, the Super Bowl weekend, Saturday afternoon at 3 PM, 3 to 7 PM next Saturday. And then Sunday, starting at midnight after the game, and then follow him on X.com at Mike Meltser with an S. Mike and I had been working together for 3 or 4 weeks when he kind of politely mentioned to me that you don't spell Meltser with a Z, you spell it with an S.
I don't even remember that. That's funny.